Thank you very much, Madam Deputy Speaker, and I'd like to extend my thanks to the Honourable Member for Hemel Hempstead and Gower for securing this debate here today. Several speakers have been quick to explain that this is about medical cannabis, not recreational use. And within the context of this debate, that's quite correct. But the fact that we feel the need to explain that is a strong indication that there is, in the wider audience, a great deal of mistrust born through ignorance of what cannabis actually is. We even start getting confused when we differentiate between cannabis and hemp. What we have here is a mess of our own making, a plant that can be grown in the UK and indeed is grown already in the UK, but under licence from the Home Office. More about that later. A plant that is good for the soil that it grows in. A plant that almost every single part of it can be utilised to make biodegradable plastics, biodegradable cloth, and, as we know, medicines. A plant that's been cultivated for thousands of years in various forms. So why do we have an issue with it? Why has cannabis been demonised? When you mention the word cannabis, why, for the majority of people, does it conjure up the image of somebody sparking up a joint, a spliff, a jay, a doobie, a roach? Because in the 1971 Misuse of Drugs Act, this place got it horribly wrong. They fell in with a prohibitionist mantra from the USA, and they made a range of drugs illegal. Prior to that, we controlled their use, we tolerated it socially, and we prescribed them as required. It was actually called the British system, and it worked. No criminal gangs controlled the production and distribution. No escalation in violence to protect the marketplace, no county lines, and a lot less corruption. And by that one incredibly clumsy act, we demonised the entire plant. I think today, if we were talking about medical hemp, a range of folk would be more open to the discussion. But because of one cannabinoid in the plant, tetrahydrocannabinol, or THC, we've ignored the other 100-plus cannabinoids and remain ignorant to the benefits they can bring and how they interact with the endocannabinoid system that each and every one of us has in our own bodies. The lack of medical research in the UK has led to an entirely unsuitable situation. My frustration is that we seem to be in no hurry to clear it up. Why are we not moving heaven and earth to license products that are used widely in other countries? Today across the UK, people are suffering needlessly. The medicines exist and are being prescribed and used elsewhere, but the UK government's attitude is that nobody knows better than us. We now find ourselves in a position where we're being forced to fight this issue one case at a time. We brought Alfie Dingley to number 10 to meet the PM. That seemed to make a difference. Billy Caldwell's mum brought the matter to a head by attempting to bring the product into the country. That moved things on too. And in their situation, wouldn't any of us do the same? Wouldn't we do whatever it took to gain access to medicine for our children? But we can't keep on fighting this on a case-by-case basis. That is cruel and it is heartless. And there are simply too many kids out there that could benefit now. And I apologise. I apologise to the many people that suffer with arthritis, multiple sclerosis and cancer. Because we don't shout about them as much. They need to be listened to. The sad fact is this government has shown that it takes the heartbreaking cases of kids with epilepsy to bring them to the table.
My honourable friend, give way on that point.
Certainly, sure.
I wonder if my honourable friend could confirm my understanding that of the 10,000 people with MS who could benefit from cannabis for medical use, nothing has changed since November 1st, 2008, when the government made it legal for specialist doctors to prescribe cannabis based on all products. Am I correct in thinking that's true?
You're absolutely correct. I've just grabbed my briefing from the MS Society here, which illustrates that point. The MS Society have said to me, since Thursday, 1st of November 2018, nobody with MS has so far benefited from the change in the law, and access to cannabis-based medicinal products remain very limited. This includes access to Sativex, a licensed product. But of course, you can get it if you can spare £500 a month to get it privately. As I've said, the system is cruel and it is heartless. Let's look at one example of how stupid our current laws are and how damaging they are to patients we're supposed to be helping. If you have a child suffering from certain forms of epilepsy, then there is good evidence that a cannabis-based medicine called Bedrolite may be of great help to your child. Any parent or guardian in that situation would want access to Bedrolite. I know of one case where a child is having 16 seizures a day and is now on Bedrolite. As of today, that child has been free of seizures for 50 days. Can we begin to imagine how great that is for the child and for his surrounding family and friends? But his supply is running out. As the mother of that child said to me yesterday, I can't let my boy get sick again. But what has she got to do to keep her boy well? The good news is, in the UK, you can get Bedrolite if you are rich. If you are rich or you can fundraise, you can go to a private clinic and pay for a prescription and then pay £560 per bottle. And for one patient that I know, that equates to £28,000 a year. And that's not the most expensive case that I know of, not by a long way. I can quote cases that will cost twice that much to medicate their children. Or if you're prepared to break the law to provide medicine for your child, you can travel to the Netherlands and purchase Bedrolite for £167 a bottle, therefore reducing your annual cost to £8,100 a year, plus travel and accommodation costs. But you risk being arrested and separated from the child that you're trying to help. I know of a case of a wee boy in Scotland whose mum has brought back oils illegally from the Netherlands. He recently went through a bad spell of cluster seizures. Normally he would be in hospital, unconscious, unable to walk, eat, speak or swallow. This time he's remained at home and has not needed any rescue medication. His mother should not have to pay thousands of pounds a month and break the law in trying to help her sick child. It's no wonder that scammers have moved into this marketplace, and as a parent of a child wrote to me yesterday to explain, the vultures are preying on the very vulnerable, desperate families and selling fake or non-filtered oils, which is unsupported and also very dangerous. And this gives us another problem. While we sit back and do nothing, scammers will move in, criminals will move in, people will say, I'm buying a product, it's cannabis, but it's not doing me any good. And then the government will take another step back and say, well, the evidence simply isn't there. Or your last option can be to do what the government has said you should do. To access medical cannabis, you must have tried medical cannabis and experienced benefits. But as I've pointed out, that involves either a lot of money or breaking the law. That's what the government's asking parents to do. You must have exhausted all other drugs, despite knowing they don't work and have got many dangerous side effects. We're asking people to endure side effects and disappointment to justify their request. And once they've done that, they find their GP can't prescribe under the current system, and that specialists are reluctant to, as they are going out on a limb, and they fear reprisals from the medical community. So what we have is a situation where the UK government says we have a system and absolves itself from the responsibility and the duty of care to the citizens of the United Kingdom. And I was going to ask the Minister if she could explain why we can't treat any cannabis-based medical products as scheduled through drugs under the statutory instrument where it's been prescribed by a medical practitioner in another jurisdiction. But of course, we've got a health minister in front of me today, not a Home Office minister. And yet again, this problem falls between two stools. Home Office or Health Office? Who's going to take responsibility for this and move it forward? Because while we delay, the privatised UK cannabis business grows. And the privatised pharmaceutical companies are controlling the available product with an iron fist. It looks like we are restricting the provision of medical cannabis while we evaluate a marketplace and develop products with the intention of making a lot of money out of it. The government wouldn't be that cruel, would it? Not deliberately. The government doesn't have a vested interest in the pharmaceutical industry, does it? It's not granting licences to its pals to grow cannabis or encouraging family members to invest in pharmaceutical companies with a vested interest, is it? Surely not. But of course we know that it absolutely is. And that's the backdrop to photo opportunities and the sympathetic words of staged understanding from government ministers. Unless you have a child living with these circumstances, then you can't possibly understand the need, the frustration and the anger. We as politicians are elected to listen to the people, and the parents and the guardians of these young men and women are screaming at us, give us access to affordable legal medication for our children, and do it now.
Julie Cooper.